to share that Lib is at home. She had a pacemaker put in, and she is at home now. Lib, Barber, she's at home. And John and Louise really appreciate all the food that has been prepared and brought over in their time of need. So I think we all need to remember that too, how we can help those in times of need. Is there anyone that needs to be added to the prayer list or any updates on the prayer list? What about birthdays? Do we have any birthdays last week or this week that we haven't covered? Jeremy? Oh my gosh, Noah's 13. All right. Wow, congratulations, 6 years. Yes. Who is that? Okay. Wow, okay. Any more birthdays? Anniversaries? Any more anniversaries? Okay, let's go ahead and sing Happy Birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Does anyone have any good news they want to share today? Yes, Beth? Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. Kaylee is in robotics and they won their competition yesterday. And you said they'll be going to Auburn? That's wonderful. Good for her. Tell her we said congratulations. A huge trophy? Awesome. Good. Yes.
Sister and brother-in-law
came with us today. Oh, good. Good. Good to see you. Welcome. Sunny's sister and brother-in-law are here today. Glad to have you with us. Thank you. Is there anyone else that has another announcement for this morning? No? I did. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Kevin.
Good morning to all. We are glad to see a nice group of smiling faces with us today, and then we know that we're anticipating a walk with the Lord this morning as we have come in the spirit of worship, in anticipation that we might feel that spirit. We're thankful for each one of you who have made the effort to be here, and for the experience that you've had in life that says to you it's worth your while to come and worship and to be with us, to be blessed and to be nurtured so that we can continue on in our lives and our endeavors, knowing that we are not alone, but that we have the good Spirit to be with us. It also helps us to remember that the good Lord is sensitive to our needs, to our feelings, and to those of the people whom we hold up in prayer, asking his blessings upon for the troubles, the sickness, the loneliness that they seek, that they endure. We hope that this morning will be a good experience for you, that you will indeed be expectant of the good Spirit, that you'll hold Roger up and each participant in this service, that the good Lord may be involved in each of their contributions. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, send your Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with love. Father, we know that we can give without loving, but we cannot love without giving. Help us love and forgive. Plant your Spirit within us to transform our lives anew. Help us keep your vision of peace. Often we take care of our own and neglect the outcast. Hear our confessions and grant us your peace so that we may reach out to the outcast around us. Let us not become weary of doing good, for at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do your will. Comfort us in our afflictions, so that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by you. Fill our spirit speaker with your Spirit as he brings our message. This I pray in your Son's name, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Normally we have a candle to light for the peace prayer, but we don't have one today. So I'm going to again ask you to invite Jesus into your life, and he will light your life. And as I give a prayer for the peace, I would like for you in your silent prayer to pray with me. Our Heavenly Father, in the day in which we live, we know that things are changing, and some say anything goes. But we know to have peace in our heart, peace in our families, peace in our community, our world, Jesus has to be in our midst. So I pray now for those families that have forgot to invite you into their home, the unrest, the adversary that moves in and takes over. I can't help but think of the families that are torn apart in the Middle East because of war and the greed. I just pray, Heavenly Father, for each of us, that we may be able to live a life that would cause someone else's light to come on by inviting Jesus into our life. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
words that I associate with today in reference to our offering and generous givers is love. We say that, I'm going to give to this and I'm going to give to that. But you know, the thing is, we give according to the degree of Christ that is within us. I want to read you from Luke. Zacharias stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anyone out of anything, I will pay back what I owe." How much are you willing to give? Is it the half of everything you have? Or does an organization touch your heart and you really want to do that? What touches my heart and Sonny's is the people that in the Victory program where they get the reduced price in medicine. It costs $25 to go see the doctor. And it's there are two brothers in Mobile. One is pastor of the Victory, or operates it as a doctor. And the other, I don't remember what his specialty is. We told a friend, "I have to work doubly hard because I've got to help my brother who's over there giving his time. I've got to help him have something to live on when he has to retire." So he does that as a result of his love for his brother. And you know, Christ was the one, or is the one, that embodies love, abundant giving. He is the one that would define it for us. And it is the Christ, when we have it in our hearts, we will become abundant givers. And we will give as he has given to us. And that's a very natural reaction to giving. Will the ushers come forth, please? Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we give you all the praise and the glory this morning for all that is, for that which you have given us, for the blessing of having each other and the children to be able to take up the offering today. Give us, Lord, what we stand in need of. Bless us in our giving and bless us in our receiving. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
I sincerely want to thank y'all for setting such a wonderful spirit. It's a good feeling up here, and I appreciate it. I hope you are sensing it as well. I also want to reaffirm for Lloyd that I'm going to keep it short. He asked me, and he said, before he even knew I was speaking, he said, sometimes I tend to fall asleep. Who's speaking today? And I said, well, it's me, Lloyd. And he said, oh, okay, well, do your best. And I said, okay, well, you too. You do your best too. Okay, speak up loud, louder. Tell me in the back. I'll do my best. So Jesus was passing through the town of Jericho on his journey to Jerusalem. In Jericho, there lived a man named Zacchaeus, who was not just a tax collector, he was a chief tax collector, meaning that he was very wealthy. Luke tells us that Zacchaeus wanted to see Jesus desperately, but because he was short and could not see over the crowd, he ran farther down the road and climbed a tree so that he could see. When Jesus arrived at the place where Zacchaeus had perched himself, he called up into the tree and said, Zacchaeus, come down from that tree. I'm going to visit your house today. So Zacchaeus came down at once and welcomed him gladly into his home. But as is always the case, the people of the crowd began to murmur. People complained, he has gone to be the guest of a sinner. Now later on, Zacchaeus tells Jesus, Lord, I will give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anyone out of anything, I will pay them back four times the amount that I owe them. Jesus responded by saying, today salvation has come to this house because this man is also a son of Abraham. What an odd story. Even today, it might seem strange that Jesus would leave behind the crowd on the street, a crowd of Jewish people, these people that had gathered together to watch the parade in downtown Jericho, call an odd little rich man out of a tree and tell him that he was going to go to his house and have lunch. Seems weird that this person that we identify as a man of wealth is somebody that Jesus would have followed home. It also seems strange that Jesus would, in a sense, say goodbye to the Jewish people on the street and go away from them, leaving them behind, to side with the person that they don't like. Now, we all know the story of Zacchaeus. I remember my daughter Emily learning the Zacchaeus song when she was young. I think Miss Mary probably taught it to her. Is that right? Okay, good. No matter what we did to my six-year-old daughter to try and explain to her that it was about a person named Zacchaeus, inevitably, no matter what we did, she sang The Kiss. I don't know if that's exactly how you taught it, Mary, or not, but she would say, The kiss, you come down. In fact, at times I think she said, the kiss, you calm down. It sounded like maybe it sometimes. Such is the insight of a six-year-old child. It's a simple song for a simple story. However, the Luke that I know doesn't tell simple, easy-to-understand stories. The Luke I know always has a hidden message. As I've said many times from this place right here, I really like Luke's gospel. Luke's story about Jesus consistently portrays him as a rebellious rabbi who is frustrated by the traditional civilization in which he finds himself. The Jesus that Luke embraces seemed to always be contrary, always to aggravate the masses by associating with the most despised, the most reviled, the disenfranchised, the vulnerable of Jewish society. Jesus hung out with the poor, the outcast, the lonely. He seemed entirely comfortable being around sinners, prostitutes, tax collectors, Samaritans, women caught in adultery, lepers, cheats, thieves, drunkards, idolaters, and murderers. The list could go on. He regularly spoke against the arrogant, against the haughty. He almost always sought change in the lives of the people by associating with the most distressed. Now, it would be easy for us to simply say that the Zacchaeus story is like other stories that we would like to admit. You know, the person that needs Jesus meets Jesus. Jesus performs a miracle. The person repents. Jesus says that they're forgiven and moves on to the next candidate. But what if that's not the message here? What if Luke is trying to tell us something else? I believe that there's a different message, and I think it's really important. I believe that Luke is trying to teach us about a Jesus that seeks social change, social justice, and renewal as much as the change of heart in Zacchaeus himself. To get at the reality of the story, it's important that we understand what tax collectors meant at the time of Jesus. Tax collectors in Jesus' time were called tellons, or gatherers by the Jews, and publicans by the Romans. Tellons were Jews who actually worked for the Roman occupation. They were apparently created by the Roman force in order to provide a bridge between the Jews and Rome. Most people saw the tax collectors as turncoats, traitors to their own nation, traitors to their culture, traitors to their religion and to their God. Rather than opposing or fighting against the Roman occupation, the tax collector seemed, from the point of the Jews, to readily accept their situation. In fact, the Jews often believed that the tax collectors helped themselves to a little off the top, maybe for expenses, from the amount of money that they took. This practice was obviously against Roman law, but if such a thing existed, it probably would have been overlooked by the Roman government. At the same time, the truth of the matter was that once a person became a tax collector, he and his family would stay in the caste system of the public and the publican family forever. The son of a tax collector was destined to be a tax collector himself. And yet, tax collectors were hated by the Jewish culture. It was a vicious circle of indentured servitude, in spite of the fact that the person that was the publican would be rich and have a comfortable life. It is probable that many of the tax collectors didn't want to be tax collectors after a time, but they had no other choice. They were lost souls who found themselves between two worlds, not allowed to be part of their culture, but not quite part of the Roman society either. They were shunned. They were obviously talked about behind closed doors. They were misunderstood, and yet no one from either society probably ever took the time to understand their plight. They were insulted by both the powerful and the powerless. They were prisoners, both bound by their contract with Rome and yet prevented from being Jewish. If ever there was a definition of outcast, it would be tax collector. And if ever there was the worst of the tax collectors, it would have been a chief tax collector. My friend Jimmy Munson would now say in a sermon, "But here come Jesus." We don't know if Jesus planned the entire incident. We don't know whether Zacchaeus and Jesus knew each other. We know that Jesus referred to Zacchaeus by name. But we don't know exactly why Jesus sought him out, and yet he did. Perhaps Jesus knew that he would eventually see Zacchaeus in the crowd and wanted to use him as part of a lesson for the rest of the people. Whatever the case, here comes Jesus. Jesus consistently intervened in the life of the small people of society, the short people, the outcasts, the hated, the unloved, the Zacchaeuses, if you will. Jesus looks at Zacchaeus up in a tree and steps away from the crowd into Zacchaeus' life. He welcomes Zacchaeus as an outcast. He brings him back into the Jewish family by inviting himself to step into Zacchaeus' world, his privacy, his space, his own vulnerability. Perhaps this is really what it means to welcome the outcast. This is probably a good time in my talk to talk about the concept of walls. There has been a great deal of talk about walls and barriers and borders lately. Walls seem to give us a sense of privacy. They give us a sense of protection. We like to have keys made to allow certain people to get inside the space of the walls. We like to prevent some people from getting inside the walls, and we like to keep some people inside of walls. Some people who are not welcomed, you know the people that I mean, the people we don't like, are prevented from entering. Funny thing about walls, though, walls are typically built to keep others out so that we can be secure. Walls provide protection. At the same time, protection comes with a price. When we live inside walls, we must ask ourselves if we are actually free. Zacchaeus, as a chief tax collector, understood walls. It is likely that he had a great security system at his house to protect his wealth, as well as to protect him from the people that hated and despised him. He was secure, but he had no liberty, no real freedom. He had wealth, to be sure, of course, but he lived literally behind walls, symbolically between two worlds, without being invited to participate in either. He was raised, of course, in Jewish tradition. He knew the significance of seeing a famous rabbi come to his town. Still, he knew what the crowd meant. The crowd, the ultimate expression of the wall. The crowd just represented the wall that separated him from a rabbi. The crowd, the barrier, obviously would have prevented him from being able to see somebody that he saw that had the ability to save him. He couldn't go through the crowd. That would have been impossible. So he does a really weird thing. He climbs a tree. He left his secure existence and climbs a tree. What an embarrassing thing that must have been for a grown man of means, a person of station in the community, a person revered and maybe reviled by people that he knew. He probably had on expensive clothes. And yet, just imagine, he's perched in a tree trying to see a rabbi over the crowd, probably recognized by certain people in the crowd, and they probably laughed at him. And yet he continued to stay in that tree. They probably thought he looked ridiculous. To make things worse, he's recognized by the rabbi. The rabbi says, "Hey, Zach, what you doing up in that tree? Come down. I'm going to go home with you right now." By calling out Zacchaeus, Jesus effectively called attention to so many problems in society. Jesus pointed to the contrasting nature of rich and poor, slave and free, popular and unpopular, in-group and out, powerful and weak, faithful and unfaithful, humble and arrogant. But most importantly, Jesus pointed to the wall that separated people. The people, the crowd, those who had their back to Zacchaeus, thought that they were living in their own little religious utopia, their own little club. They had their faces pointing inward toward each other from across the street, believing that all of the evils of the world could be shut out by putting their backs to them. They were excited to see their Jesus. In their minds, as with many, he represented change and eventual domination for the Jewish people again. And to them, here comes Jesus. Jesus shattered the wall from within by calling up from within their midst. Jesus pointed out that the wall, the crowd, the separation was actually the problem, not the solution. Jesus, as he always did, re-enfranchised the outcast, the lost. Of course, the crowd, the group, didn't like what he had to say. They didn't like what they were experiencing. The masses did not want Jesus to leave them. So they murmured, "The master is speaking to a sinner." But to make matters worse, Jesus has the audacity to tell Zacchaeus by name that he's going to his house, essentially shattering another wall, a social taboo. Now, this is important. There is a big difference between inviting a person into our walls, our home, our secure space, and going into theirs. It is easy for us to have a person over for a short visit on our terms. It is completely a different thing to show the crowd that you have enough faith in that other person that you're willing to leave your security and go into their life. A superficial Jesus would have simply asked Zacchaeus to come down out of that silly tree and join him in the parade. But that's not what Jesus does. He calls for change. I think it should be also noted that there's a subtle but very significant difference between the King James Version of this story and the New Revised Standard Version of this story. And it all has to do with two little words in verse 8. If you look at the back of your program, you'll see the NRSV. Verse 8 reads this in the original Greek, or in the NRSV. "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." The King James Version reads this: "Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold." Both passages end with Jesus saying, "Today, salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man comes to seek out and to save the lost." Did you see the small, subtle difference in the two scriptures? Jesus welcomes Zacchaeus back into the family of Abraham before Zacchaeus ever returns any of the money back to anybody. He does so because Zacchaeus is a member of the community. King James obviously wants Zacchaeus to repent first. Jesus accepts him as part of the group. Where does that leave you and me? Too often, I believe that we want to think of ourselves as Zacchaeus. We want to see us as a character in this story that is the outcast. We want to believe that we are those who are deprived, who are taken advantage of, or at least perhaps to some degree in this case. Each of us at times feel as though the crowd has its back to us. that we are not allowed to see the parade because we're not as popular as the rest of the group. You know what I mean. Sometimes we feel like we're outside trying to look in. Sometimes we feel like climbing a tree may be our only way of being able to see what's really going on. But more often we act like the crowd. We like to face inward, toward each other, trying hard not to acknowledge the problems out there. Sometimes we like to promote our wall more than our calling. We would at times prefer to keep others out. We want to prevent others from getting our stuff. We don't want the sinful or the outcasts of the world coming into our society, at least not too much. We don't mind those who are outside temporarily being included in our group, as long as they mind their manners and promptly leave. We are much more willing to invite people into our sacred spaces, inside our safe and secure walls, when we can control them. Don't get me wrong, we love it when a new person walks in the door of our church, as long as we know them, or as long as they look like us, as long as they talk like us, share our values, like our football team, or at least our conference, yay Big Ten, best I could do. We like it when people understand us before they enter. We like it when people are like us when they enter. We like it when people are us when they enter. People are welcome as long as they fit. As long as they don't stay too long on our side of the wall. But here comes Jesus. Jesus expects us to leave, to let go of our security. He expects us to go out there, down this street, a mile on the right side, where the danger is, where the murder took place. Jesus expects us to go, to let go of our security. Jesus expects us to go to the place where people are vulnerable and hurting and despised and smell bad and have very little. We are called to enfranchise the disenfranchised. We are called to love the unloved, to walk with those on the other side of our society. We are called to take down the walls and separate ourselves from the walls so that we can be part of the reality of the ministry of Christ. We are called to a world crying for the type of Jesus that we take for granted. We are called to the lives that need us desperately. We are called to go to their house. I was reminded this week of a book that I had when I was very young. Anybody remember that book? Anybody ever seen that picture before? It's a children's book that I was given when I was very young. It's It's one of the first books I remember. The book is called If Jesus Came to My House. I don't know how many of you have ever heard of that book before. It's been translated. I looked this up because I looked all over the house for the book and I can't find it. Mom, I'm sorry. I hope I haven't lost it. It's been translated into several different languages, and it's on its 19th edition. Whew. That's amazing. The book's about a little boy who wonders what it would be like if Jesus visited him. He would like the visit to be with the Jesus that's his own age, so that he'll have somebody to play with. The boy says in the book that he would show Jesus around his house, and they would play in his yard, and they would play with his toys, and they would play on his swing, and he would show Jesus all of the secret places where he has gone in his house, and they would have a delightful day. It's a charming little book that I remember with great fondness. At least, except for the illustrations. The illustrations really kind of confused me as a child. There was a time when I really thought that Jesus wore a dress and that he was barefoot all the time. The only good part about the picture up there is that for a six-year-old Roger, I thought that he had a space helmet on. And that was kind of neat. He was a cool Jesus because he was like astronaut Jesus. But the rest of it was kind of confusing. At the time, of course, I didn't realize that the astronaut thing was Halo. I just thought that he was kind of like Flash Gordon or something. Still, the idea that Jesus might actually like to play with my toys was kind of a neat thrill for me as a kid. It meant that I wasn't an outsider. But it also meant that I would have to share with Jesus. Not an easy thing for a 5 or 6 year old kid to understand. One of the very last statements in the book, I looked it up, couldn't find the real book, but one of the last statements in the book reads this. I still can share with Jesus the nicest of my toys by lending them or giving them to poorer girls or boys. And though he may not visit me as I have wished he could, yet even so, he'll bless my house if I am kind and good. This is obviously at a point in the story where the narrator, the little boy, is realizing that Jesus doesn't just pop into your house. Although I love this last picture. It kind of reminded me of Zacchaeus. That's why I grabbed it. We're not 5 and 6 years old anymore. So perhaps the author should say, in light of this better understanding of Zacchaeus, and in awareness of our responsibility to be the hands and feet of Jesus, perhaps the author should have said it this way. I still can share with Jesus the nicest of my toys by lending them or giving them to poorer girls and boys. Or I could go to their house the way I wish he would. And in so doing, visit others as Jesus said I should. As much as it is scary and dangerous and sometimes thought-provoking for us to even imagine leaving the sanctity and protection of these walls, this is our calling. This is what we are expected to do. I know that there are dangers just down the street. I've been there. It's scary. But I look to the day when people in our neighborhood say, here comes the community of Christ.
Let us give thanks to the Lord for this service today. Our kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for all Your blessings and Your efforts to help us to continue to trust in Your grace. As we respond to the love and the leadings of the Spirit, we have come before You in unity and love.
as the Lord has blessed us with a great outpouring of compassion for each of us and for the world as we respond to the call to go and testify to those around us. Thank you, dear Lord, for your watch care as we go from here to our separate places. And it's in Jesus' most holy name we pray. Amen.